thanks to UP Travel for supporting this video. Oh my gosh, that's a view. Holy cow. Hey there! If you wanted to raise a 1,000-foot-long, about 70,000-ton freighter more than 20 feet, how would you do it? Cranes? A huge elevator? How about some gates and 20 million gallons of water? Because that's how they're doing it behind me. Welcome to the Soo Locks. This is the story behind one of the most critical pieces of infrastructure in the United States. The engineering behind how it works, the geology behind why it's needed, and some adventures I would have never thought possible. It's story time. I'm standing on the St. Mary's River in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, and this river is the only waterway connecting Lake Superior with Lake Huron. So if you want to get a freighter from any of the iron mines in the north to any of the processing facilities down south, this is the only way to go. In fact, 95% of the high-strength steel made in the United States, that's used in domestic cars and appliances and more, it currently requires iron that is shipped down this waterway. The problem? This area used to be all rapids. Here's the story. If you grew up near the Great Lakes, you probably learned about the glaciers. Super heavy sheets of ice that dragged rocks and sediment across the ground and scoured out the lakes starting roughly around 20,000 years ago. Well, there's a little more to the story than just that. One thing I didn't learn in school is that the land still hasn't recovered from being squished by all that super heavy ice. It's been rebounding ever since the glaciers left. For an analogy, imagine sitting on a couch. You sink into the cushion a little, and when you stand back up, that cushion doesn't immediately snap back to its original position. It slowly rises up. Well, that's what the ground is doing. It's called isostatic rebound, and it's happening faster in the north than in the south. So around 2100 years ago, and driven by isostatic rebound, the rock ledges here in Sault Ste. Marie were lifted above the water levels of Lake Huron and continued to slowly rise. Today, there's about a 20-foot drop over a short stretch of the St. Mary's River, and with that, originally, came a whole lot of rapids. What's fascinating to me is that 2100 years ago isn't actually very long in the past. People were living here and had been for quite some time. So over many generations, they got to see this event unfold in real time, which I just think is really cool. Ultimately, these rapids became a great gathering place for local Anishinaabe. Every spring, as many as 25,000 people may have come here to fish and celebrate community, and this is still a common fishing spot. In other words, this place had a life and history of its own long before the Soo Locks. However, fast forward many generations to after settlers and colonizers had taken control of this area, and by the mid-1800s, these folks considered the rapids less of a beautiful community gathering spot and more of a beautiful barrier to shipping on the Great Lakes. A small navigation lock had been built here in the 1790s, but that was destroyed in the War of 1812. So by the mid-1800s, ships that picked up iron, copper, and lumber along the shores of Lake Superior had to stop at the mouth of the St. Mary's River, unload their boats, carry all their stuff down to the base of the rapids, repack, and then start on their journey again. And especially with mining starting to pick up in the western Upper Peninsula, it was time to build another way for ships to get down the river. In June 1853, the Fairbanks Scale Company, a company with extensive mining investments in the Upper Peninsula, broke ground on what would become the Soo Locks. By this point, locks had been around for centuries as a way to raise and lower boats on what I'll call uneven waterways. And how they work is pretty straightforward. If a boat needs to go down, it enters a gated area and water is carefully let out the front until the water levels equalize. If the boat needs to go up, then water is allowed to flow in from a higher elevation. There are different ways to make this happen, but the overall idea is pretty simple. Still, that doesn't mean that construction here went perfectly smoothly. At the beginning, shanties and a hospital were built to accommodate 300 to 400 workers. But even with them working 11.5-hour days, it wasn't enough.
So more men were brought in, maxing out at a group of more than 1,700. With the influx of people, the work camps were crowded and unsanitary, and by the end of summer 1854, as many as 10% of the workers had died thanks to a cholera outbreak. Things like this always remind me that history is not just like a story in a book. People's family trees contain men who died trying to build a shipping route, along with plenty of others who were able to thrive and provide for their families because of it. Like many events from this time, the cholera outbreak did ultimately get overshadowed by the fact that the locks were completed within their two-year deadline. There were two of them in a row, each 350 feet long, and the first ship passed through on June 22, 1855. Around 30 years later, Michigan transferred ownership of the locks to the federal government, and they've been under the jurisdiction of the Army Corps of Engineers ever since. Now, the locks we have today in Sault Ste. Marie aren't the same ones that opened in 1855. New locks have been built at this spot as things fell apart and shipping needs changed. Today, there are two operational locks on the American side and one on the Canadian side. And before I show you all of the locks, I should tell you about the first of two unexpected adventures on this trip. Because I didn't just see the Soo Locks from the public observation deck or the public boat tour. I also found a more unexpected spot. So this is the International Bridge, which connects Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan with Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. Well, after I wrote the script for this video, I got connected with the International Bridge Administration, who offered me the opportunity to film the Soo Locks from the bridge. But in the most interesting way possible. Instead of just filming from the bridge deck, they asked, hey, do you want to climb to one of the top of the arches? And how could I say no to that? So harnessed up and accompanied by a group of steeplejacks, we climbed to the top of the bridge, which is some 220 feet above the ground. And we got an incredible view of the Soo Locks. Oh my gosh. I've wanted to use that music track for years. That just came out so much cooler than I thought it was going to. Okay. Now, let's head back down to the ground by the river and I'll tell you more of what you were just looking at.
In the US, we have the MacArthur Lock, which was built in 1943 and is 800 feet long. There's also the Poe Lock, which is larger at about 1,200 feet long. It opened in the 1960s. Finally, there's also another lock under construction that will be just as big as the Poe, and that should open in 2030. Meanwhile, on the other side of the river, the Canadian lock is just for pleasure craft. Except for a little over 2 months of the year, starting in mid-January, these locks are all open and operating 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, including like literally right now as I'm filming this. And anyway, their design isn't that much more complicated than the basic setup I described earlier. As ships approach, they call the chief lock master for a lock assignment.
Roger, it'll be up the pole and a turn back from the St. Laurent. As soon as you get room, you can put it on the end of the pier until
you get the green light.
If all is well, they'll get an assignment about 30 minutes before they arrive. When they roll in, deckhands are lowered off the ship, where they pass their boat's ropes, or lines, over to linemen from the Army Corps of Engineers. The linemen then secure those ropes to what are called buttons on the lock, and a winch operator can keep the lines tight and the ship stable as water levels go up or down. So the boat comes in, a filling valve closes, the emptying valve opens on the other side of the lock, and the water drains out. The crew gets their lines back, and the boat heads down the river and on its way to Lake Huron. Or going the other way, the filling valve opens, letting water flood in from Lake Superior. Once the boat is secured in the locks, it takes about 15 to 20 minutes for this process to happen because a lot of water has to move in or out of the lock, and it all happens naturally in the sense that the water isn't mechanically pumped in or out. For the MacArthur lock, that means about 10 million gallons of water. For the Poe, it's more like 22 million. And for the crew on these ships, that time isn't wasted. Those 15 to 20 minutes are used to hop on shore and do things like pick up mail and exchange dirty laundry for clean laundry. There's no toll for ships to pass through the locks. They're indirectly funded through a tax paid by companies who buy the cargo. But one thing that doesn't drive up the budget is power. The power needed to operate any machinery on the Soo Locks, like the gates, comes from the river itself. Part of the river is diverted down a canal, and as it falls, that energy makes hydroelectric power. The U.S. hydroelectric power plant makes the power needed for the locks, and then sells the rest for use in local homes and businesses.
Since the Soo Locks are the only way for big ships to get between Lake Superior and Lake Huron, it's kind of hard to overstate how important they are, which isn't something I'd fully realized before starting on this video. Like, this place is so critical to U.S. infrastructure that it was one of the most heavily guarded places in the country during World War II. There were more than 7,000 soldiers stationed in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan in Ontario, along with barbed wire, anti-aircraft guns, defensive balloons, and torpedo nets. And like I mentioned earlier, today, 95% of the high-strength steel made in the United States requires iron that moves through the Soo Locks. Most of that traffic goes through the larger Poe Lock. And according to a 2015 study by the Department of Homeland Security, if the Poe Lock ever shut down unexpectedly for, say, 6 months, the U.S. steel industry would grind to a halt and the U.S. GDP would drop by, get this, about $1.1 trillion. This is a big part of why they're building another lock at the Soo that's the same size as the Poe. And here's the part where I tell you about my second unexpected adventure in the Soo. So while researching this video, I had reached out to the Army Corps of Engineers, who runs the Soo Locks, and I'd asked if there was any way I could speak with someone for 15 to 30 minutes about construction on the new lock. I had some questions and was just kind of also curious if there were any challenges in building a new lock that I might not have thought of. To my surprise and absolute joy, the Army Corps of Engineers got back to me with an offer for 3 interviews and a behind-the-scenes tour of the lock on the other side of the government security fence. It was an incredible experience, and I learned so much from these brilliant and lovely people that I've decided to make that behind-the-scenes tour its own separate video. This is wild, man. If you'd like to get notified when it goes live, you can of course subscribe if you're not already, or you can sign up for my newsletter at alexisdahl.com/newsletter, and you'll get an email when it's finished. It was really fascinating, and I am extremely excited to share that with you. But for now, here is a little bit of my conversation with Rachel, an engineer who did indeed tell me more about construction on the new lock.
So my name is Rachel Miller. I'm a supervisory civil engineer. That's my title here. I also serve as the contracting officer's representative for the New Lock at the Soo mega project. So that means I interface with the contractor on a daily basis, overseeing construction for the New Lock project. we awarded the new lot contract a couple summers ago, summer of 2022. The contractor is really going into their second full season. Really, one of the challenges that we have to work through is the fact that the new lock is being built on the footprint of two existing locks, which means that we need to do something with those two existing locks first. And then on top of that, we're also building in the middle of a river. The site is literally an island. So the two existing locks, the Davis lock and the Sabin lock, over 100 years old. There's a lot of unknowns when you're dealing with old structures. So because of that, we have what we call monolith stability measures that are there in order to reinforce those monoliths and make sure that they don't try to move when we start removing the water. So when we go out on site, you'll be able to see there's actually lock struts spanning the locks in order to help push against the lock walls just in case. It's very much a precautionary measure, as I'm sure you would guess, between the 19 teens when those locks were built and 2024, design standards change.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Things like factors of safety change. And that's one of the big reasons for that. So we've got lock struts, there's rock anchors in place. There's actually some areas where we excavated material from behind the concrete monoliths to unload on the other side, civil engineering is all about balance. So
yeah. We're
removing the pressure from the water on the face. We're also removing the soil from the backside to help maintain that balance.
Okay, so one maybe obvious question, someone who's not an engineer.
Sure.
Why not make it bigger?
So we get that question a lot.
I figured you might, yeah.
So our designer actually refers to the new lock as Poe 2.0, in part because the dimensions are the same. And there are some innovations. There's some things that are being updated for the new lock, as I'm sure you can imagine. The Poe was built in the 60s. And actually, the Poe has had some upgrades along the way. One of the advantages of doing that is you get interoperability. So we can ask for an extra set of culvert valves or a miter gate and be able to use it on either lock. So you have spare parts that can apply for either. The other thing is the staff here on site, we don't want them to have to relearn or do something completely different in order to operate the new lock or maintain the new lock within reason, right? There's going to be improvements to the way that we do things over time. But for the most part, we want the staff to be able to maintain and operate the locks in relatively a similar manner. So there's no really what I would call earth-shattering changes in the design between the two locks. So the Soo Locks are very much they're an engineering marvel, I think. So I don't live here,
sure.
So I'm kind of commenting as an outsider, but they're very much tied to the Great Lakes as a whole. And the reason why I say that is there's locks all over the United States. They're primarily on rivers, and one of the things we don't have to deal with is changes in river elevations. The lakes are relatively very stable. I'd also say that they're very much a part of the Great Lakes in the sense that the freighters that traverse them, they're basically trapped on the Great Lakes. This is the only elevator for them. So it's almost like a symbiotic relationship between the freighters and the Soo Locks.
Yeah, cool. That's a really good way to put that. Thanks. Well, thank you. This was so lovely. I really appreciate it.
Are we going on a tour? Do you want to see the site?
I would love to see everything. Today, more than 7,000 boats and 75 million tons of cargo move through the Soo Locks every year. They're busier than the Panama and Suez canals combined. And if we had to move all of that cargo by truck or train, it would cost almost an extra $4 billion. As someone who grew up in Michigan, I had always sort of known about the Soo Locks, but never really thought of them as a place I would like want to visit. But as has happened so many times throughout the series, after taking the time to learn a little bit of their story, I am now deeply impressed and am so grateful to have had the opportunity to spend some time here. Thanks to UP Travel for supporting this video. You can learn more about Sault Ste. Marie, the Soo Locks, and the rest of the Upper Peninsula at uptravel.com and can follow them on social media for tips for planning a visit. And as always, thanks for being here. I hope you learned something that makes you think about the world just a little differently. And first, I'm gonna look at this boat, but then I'll see you soon.